motivated.
Get motivated.
Get motivated. Hip hop motivator, blowing wisdom on the mic with Sean Anthony.
Get motivated.
Get it right with Sean Anthony.
Get motivated. Get motivated.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to a live edition of Flow of Wisdom Radio. Those of you who are listening online, gcnlive.com, and we definitely appreciate you rocking out with me. Every Sunday, 3 to 5 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, we do this show live. The toll-free number to call in is 877-300-7645, 877-300-7645. Listen, we are on part two of a series entitled CERN, Portals, and Ley Lines. CERN, Portals, and Ley Lines. And I tell you, this is one fascinating subject. This is very, very interesting to me because we're talking about technology. We're talking about, especially with the CERN, we're talking about the merging of science and religion. Because you have these scientists that they built this one of the biggest, most highest technology on the planet, the biggest machine on the planet in Switzerland. That goes into like around a 17-mile radius, tinkering into the border of France and Switzerland. And we're talking about the largest, strongest magnets ever created, with the goals of colliding particles, the Large Hadron Collider. This is a fascinating piece of equipment that these scientists from all over the parts of the world come together and looking for this quote unquote God particle. This is something interesting. Genesis 11, it says, and the whole world was of one language and of one speech. And it came to pass as they journeyed from the east that they found a plain in the land of Shinar, and they dwelt there, and they said one to another, go to, let us make brick and burn them thoroughly. And they had brick for stone, and slime had they for mortar. And they said, go to, let us build us a city and a tower whose top may reach unto heaven, and let us make us a name, lest we be scattered abroad upon the earth of the upon the face of the whole earth. And the Lord came down to see the city and the tower which the children of men builded. And the Lord said, behold, the people is one, and they have all one language, and this they begin to do. And now nothing will be restrained from them, which they have imagined to do. Go, let us go down, go to, and let us go down, and there confound their language, that they may not understand one another's speech. So the Lord scattered them abroad and from thence upon the face of all the earth, and they left off to build the city. Therefore, it is the name of it called Babel, because the Lord did there confound the language of all the earth. And from thence did the Lord scatter them abroad upon the face of all the earth. The Tower of Babel. In Genesis, the scriptures say how powerful man's mind can be when in a collective agreement. Hence, one world government, one world religion, one world order. Those scriptures tell us how the Antichrist possibly believes how they could go against the Heavenly Father. Man can do whatever he puts his mind to, and it's even more powerful when man has one vision, one thought. That's it's always good for corporate structures that you have to have a vision in place. You have to have a mission statement so that everyone within the corporation can drive the company into that one direction. It's a principle. And in Genesis, it shows us when they were trying to build the Tower of Babel. The Heavenly Father came down and seen whatever comes to this man's mind, to man's mind, they can have it. It's in Proverbs. As a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. It's powerful. Now, I bring up the Tower of Babel because you look at what they're doing in Switzerland with CERN, the Large Hadron Collider. You have these bright minds, these physicists coming from different parts of the world together to, and what it's called, ladies and gentlemen, singularity. Singularity is finding a particle and reducing it to its smallest stage. So boom, you find this particle here. You try to separate it and cut that in half and see what's inside that, and then cut that in half and see what's inside that, cut that in half, and so that you get to the smallest particle. And what they're calling it, the God particle. They are trying to see what's holding the universe together. Now, see, people that read the scriptures and follow the Bible, or, you know, other sects out there, religious sects that follow the scriptures, it's a thing that we call faith. You know, now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Not seen. Now, when you look at CERN, what they're doing, they are looking for dark matter. On their website, invisible dark matter makes up most of the universe, but we can only detect it from its gravitational effects. You hear that? This is science, okay? Invisible dark matter makes up most of the universe, but we can only detect it from its gravitational effects. Now, in the scriptures, it says, now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. The evidence of things not seen, but can only detect it from its gravitational effects. That's amazing, man. Wow. You are seeing the emergence of science and religion. What are these physicists over there? What is their main objective? And it's always, you know, when I did the series on the Boule, and, you know, you start talking about other fraternities and sororities or what have you, and even Freemasonry, what have you. And it's like, you know, those that come in from the ground level may have one ideology in mind and a perceived notion on how the structure is set up. However, you have a small group of individuals at the top, at the very, very beginning of it, that keep the core ideology and the direction that they want to go with this particular organization. Their ideas and direction that they want to go may not be the same as, let's say, you know, the janitor that works in Switzerland at the CERN Hadron Collider. You know, the new physicists that just came out of school, you know, just wrote their paper. They just graduated, you know, and they have this awesome internship opportunity at this new facility. Well, not new facility, but at this facility to intern at the Hadron Collider. The mindset and the ideology is probably coming from two different perspectives. I hope I'm making sense to about what I'm saying to you guys. But I just wonder, the guys that sit in those private meetings, those private discussions on the direction that they want to go with this collider and looking for dark matter. They're bold, proudly looking for dark matter. And it's very, very interesting. Dark matter, on their CERN website, that says it's unlike normal matter. Dark matter does not interact with the electromagnetic force. It doesn't work together. This together, dark energy makes up approximately 68% of the universe, and it appears to be associated with the vacuum in space. It is distributed evenly throughout the universe, not only in space, but also in time. In other words, its effect is not diluted as the universe expands. The even distribution means that dark energy does not have any local gravitational effects, but rather a global effect on the universe as a whole. This leads to a repulsive force, which tends to accelerate the expansion of the universe. The rate of expansion and its acceleration can be measured by observations based on the Hubble law. These measurements, together with other scientific data, have confirmed the existence of dark energy and provide an estimate of just how much of this mysterious substance exists. They are in the search of the unknown. Oh man, this is exciting. Guys, please chime in. Let's get involved with the conversation. The subject, CERN portals and ley lines, 877-300-7645. And we'll be back with more on Floral Wisdom Radio. All right, welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. Flow of Wisdom Radio. I am Sean Anthony, and the toll-free number is 1-877-300-7645. Shouts out to Mr. Dude 2012 on Twitter. Great minds think alike. We're on the same same mindset. My man sent me a link of an article I have in my notes to share. I just retweeted it to you guys, those that are following me on Twitter, at Sean_Anthony. There's some other articles, too, that I'm going to share as well, Mr. Dude 2012, that came out recently, in fact. Let me jump into the one that he just sent me. It's on TechCrunch.com. And the title is CERN Releases 300 Terabytes of Large Hadron Collider Data into Open Access. 300 terabytes. And what is it? Katie LaCilla Perini, who is a physicist who works on the compound muon solenoid detector, gave a refreshingly straightforward explanation for this huge release. Why is it the question? Why would they release 300 terabytes of information or data, if you will, of the Large Hadron Collider? Why are they doing this open access? Her response is, once we've exhausted our exploration of the data, we see no reason not to make them available publicly. The benefits are numerous, from inspiring high school students to the training of the particle physicists of tomorrow. And personally, as CMS's data preservation coordinator, this is a crucial part of ensuring the long-term availability of our research data. Now, let me just tell you this side note. This is great that they're showing this access of this information. But I'm just almost certain that many people are not going to be checking for this kind of information. You know what I'm saying? I mean, let's just be real. You know, if Beyonce puts out something new on HBO, you know, tweeting about it all week about some lemonade, the masses are going to be checking for Beyonce, seeing what Rihanna's going to do, you know, in her next video, or you know, who the next idol is going to be, who's going to be the best dancer on Dancing with the Stars. Like, these are the other things that most people in America, and maybe, hopefully I'm wrong. But this type of stuff, you know, not many are going to be checking for this kind of information. And I know and understand that, and that, you know. So, Sean, why are you doing a series on CERN? Exactly. Because most people aren't checking for this kind of information. Most people aren't doing shows on this kind of stuff. The kind of topics that I may cover. But, man, when I was in the hip-hop industry, whenever I was interviewing, G-Unit or Rick Ross on the show, everybody was checking in. You know, it got a lot of hits. You know, but when I do this type of stuff, you know, it's a select few, and I get it. It's all good. I just hope and pray that you guys would, see the benefit in it and spread and share this information. But nonetheless, they're releasing 300 terabytes of information on the Large Hadron Collider. I just wonder how many people will download that information or go, you know, and search it out. But nonetheless, they're making it act. They're accessing. And then again, they, you know, like they do. I won't say they, but the powers, the quote unquote powers that be, you know, they like to hide it in plain sight for you. You know, sometimes, you know, you're just not going to be checking for certain things. But anyway, there's another article that was just released yesterday, and it was in Science World. It was on the Science World report of Stephen Hawking. You know, I mentioned him last week on the show, who's been vocal about being against what they're trying to do with the Hadron Collider in CERN. He's been just vocally against it and talking about the dangers and what could possibly happen. But anyway, in a recent lecture he held at Harvard University, he was on the subject of black holes and how black holes, and I'm quoting from this article, could be portals to a parallel universe. All right? I'm going to finish this up here when we come back from the break. Stephen Hawking, he said that black holes, they could be portals to a parallel universe. Very interesting, huh? Especially for a scientist to be speaking at Harvard University. We'll be back with more on this subject after this on Floor Wisdom Radio. All right, ladies and gentlemen, welcome back. Floor of Wisdom Radio. Yours truly, Sean Anthony, live every Sunday, 3 to 5 p.m. Eastern Standard Time on the Genesis Communications Network. Shouts out to one of the fam here in Richmond, Virginia, broadcasting the show live. And also shouts out to all of the affiliates that are carrying the show. I definitely appreciate it. And the toll-free number, of course, is 1-877-300-7645. We're live in Barstow, California, Chattanooga, Tennessee, Forks, Washington, Washington State, on those stations, 23 AM in California, 99.3 FM in Tennessee, and 96.7 FM in Washington. So I definitely appreciate it. We got to get on to more affiliates, guys, and I need your help. Call your local radio station and say, hey, we want Flow of Wisdom Radio. All right, let's go to the phone lines. We have Dave in the Thumb wants to talk about CERN. And if I'm not mistaken, Dave, that's in Michigan, the thumb part of Michigan, right, Dave?
That's right, Sean. How you doing, my friend?
I'm doing great, man. Good to hear from you, man. What's your thoughts on CERN?
Well, I got to tell you, I was listening to another network a couple of weeks ago, April 7th, as a matter of fact, the Kev Baker Show. He's out of Scotland. He was interviewing a couple of folks, a gal named, I believe it's Elena Kagan. I mean, not Kagan. Elena, oh, what a Freudian slip that was. Elena Freeland, and she and a gentleman named Billy Hayes. Billy Hayes is an MK Ultra survivor, and he actually was the guy who headed up the crew that built HARP in Alaska. He built the two test sites and the main site in Alaska, and he was compartmentalized. He didn't know what it was for. He just thought he was erecting antennas, right? Mm-hmm. Well, Elena wrote a book with Billy's expertise, and it's called Chemtrails, HARP, and the Full Spectrum Domination of Planet Earth. And she's also writing a book right now called The Space Fence. They told a story about how HARP, chemtrails, windmill farms, CERN, oil wells that are 7,285 feet deep, and fracking wells, they're all antennas. And they are putting static electricity, millions of watts, into the atmosphere, heating up the atmosphere. And they are able to, well, they plan on controlling every living creature on the planet with all of those technologies combined together. So if you, I don't know if you know who Kev Baker is. He's got a great show on another network.
Yeah, I'm familiar. I think I've checked out a couple of his podcasts in the past.
Yeah, he's some really good stuff. But now also one other thing, it's off topic, but on the Kev Baker show, he does a Freaky Friday show on Friday nights with a host of other talk show radio hosts from his network. It's like a round table. They were talking about Prince, right? One of the guys, his name is Popeye. He's got a website, federaljack.com. In 06, he found a video of Prince doing a concert in the Netherlands from 1998. And Prince very clearly says, he's singing a song, right? And he says, Bin Laden's going to blow up America. In 1998, nobody ever even really heard of Bin Laden. That's pretty cryptic stuff. And then they played some interviews of Dick Gregory interviewing Prince, talking about chemtrails and the like. Mm-hmm. Now Prince died on the 111th day of the year. The powers that shouldn't be devil worshippers, they're really into the numerology stuff, right?
Mm-hmm.
So that's a big number, 111. And Prince also died on the Queen's birthday.
Hmm. Interesting.
That's, yeah. So anyway, I know you got other callers, and I love your show. Keep up the great work, and check that stuff out. April 7th, the Kev Baker Show, and Elena Freeland and Billy Hayes.
Excellent point. You know, Dave, thanks for the call. I appreciate it, man.
Hey, you're welcome.
Yeah, and I'm going to tie into some of the things that Dave was talking about because, when he brought up the Elaine talking about chemtrails, HARP, and the space fence and all of that stuff, I was going over some of my old stuff and my old interview with Wilbur Allen, who I've had on the show numerous times throughout the years, who's had, he's a UFO expert. He photographs all of these anomalies that take place in the skies. He's said numerous times on the show that he's been abducted. He's had encounters with these aliens. Some like to deject the term alien. Some may say, demons or what have you. But nonetheless, one of the things that Wilbur Allen said to tie in what Dave was just talking about on that other show, he was saying how HARP technology, and you guys can go back and check out those interviews with Wilbur Allen. I think I had him on the show last year. I have him on the show at least once or twice a year, so it's almost time for me to have him back on. But anyway, he talks. He mentioned in the previous interview with me where he believes that the HARP technology facility in Alaska, because there are more than one HARP platforms here in the world, but they are tied into creating a wormhole, a portal, if you will, outer space. And he says that chemtrails and HARP technology, all of that is tied in together. So what Dave in Michigan is referring to is merely confirming information that I've had on my show from my guests. So, I don't doubt that at all. I mean, it all makes sense. You put two and two together. You look at the HARP technology, what they do. They're shooting, like Dave mentioned, they're shooting this energy into the ionosphere that can dictate and manipulate the climate. So, and tying it into all of this other technology that they have, these telescopes, the Vatican and their huge telescope called Lucifer, okay, and where it's located, on Mount Graham. Mount Graham in Arizona is where they have this telescope, this space station, not space station, but where they have these different telescopes to look out into the atmosphere. One of the most powerful, if not the most powerful telescope, is Lucifer. It's called Lucifer. That's right. And it's the Vatican. It's amazing, right? I mean, Popular Science put out an article. I've talked about this before on the show, but this is an old article back in 2010 from Popular Science talking about this new instrument with an evil-sounding name is helping scientists see how stars are born. Lucifer, which stands for Large Binocular Telescope Near Infrared Utility with Camera and Integral Field Unit for Extragalactic Research. That's the name of it. And I shared this with you guys last week on the show, but it's never a problem to bring it up more information again so that we could all get it. But anyway, Lucifer, this telescope, it's part of the Large Binocular Telescope, which happens to be right next to the Vatican Observatory on Mount Graham in Tuscan, Arizona. Now, the Vatican has an observatory in Arizona, and it's manned by Jesuit astronomers. Okay? The scientists have five German universities designated that designed the instrument, and they came up with the name. But here's a little side note, some information that I found when I was researching this information. One little sidebar story to give you context about this Mount Graham, this telescope Lucifer, the state of Arizona, and the particular location where this telescope Lucifer stands. And I'm going to get back to that article that I started in the last segment on Stephen Hawking. Don't think I forgot, guys. I'm going to share it, okay? But just to give you some context on this Mount Graham. Now, Mount Graham is considered sacred land by the Native Americans, the Apache Indians, okay? This is considered sacred, sacred land. And they have been in a battle for years. I would say it would be safe to say for decades, fighting against the Vatican and the University of Arizona and the government, if you will, court battles, protests, so on and so forth, trying to prevent them from building on what the Apache Indians consider sacred land, Mount Graham. Why is this land so sacred? Well, because of the energy that particular area, that the type of energy that resonates from there, for the spiritual, some would say, anomalies that would happen in that region, on that mountain, Mount Graham, the type of things that have happened, things that have seen spiritually, according to the Apache Indians. This is sacred land. And what does the Vatican do? Along with the University of Arizona, they land grab. They land grab, they bully, they muscle. They in courts, and I'm paraphrasing this, guys, because it's a lot of, I've read a lot of information over the past week on this particular subject, and I ran through several emotions while reading this. It pissed me off because it's like, dag, man, like they just have no respect for people and their lands and their beliefs or what have you. This was their country at first anyway. Let's just put that out there in the open, all right? I mean, it's obvious, it's an elephant in the room. But nonetheless, they told the Apache Indians, well, this is not sacred land because you have no monuments or nothing, no memorial or anything here to consider it sacred. That's how they treated the people and their own land. How sad is that? All right, look, when I come back, I'm going to read this article of Stephen Hawking speaking at Harvard University. It's after this on Flow of Wisdom Radio. Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. Flow of Wisdom Radio. I am Sean Anthony. My website is flowofwisdom.com. On there, I've had the interview with Prince and Tavis Smiley. It's been on flowofwisdom.com for several years now. Prince talking about his conversations with Dick Gregory on chemtrails and some other interesting topics that we tend to cover on Flow of Wisdom Radio. Coming up, I may share that excerpt, but also coming up, there's a clip of when I interviewed Dick Gregory, of him talking about something very interesting, to say the least. We'll play that in the second hour. And also, I'm going to get into this article here from Stephen Hawking talking about black holes. But right now, let's go to the phone lines, 877-300-7645. We have Christina in Florida, wants to talk about CERN. Christina, welcome to Flow of Wisdom. How are you?
I'm great. How are you?
I'm doing good. What are your thoughts on CERN?
I was listening to your opening when you were reading about the Tower of Babel. And when God came down and confused their language,
mm-hmm.
Well, man has, I guess, in a sense, undone that, because you got people from all different nations now able to communicate through media, through the internet.
Mm-hmm.
So they make their language one again.
Mm-hmm.
What do you think?
Absolutely. That's why I alluded to the fact that, you know, you look at what's going on now. The statement when I said it, the scriptures tell us that how the Antichrist believes how they could go against the Heavenly Father again. You know, man,
right.
can do whatever they put their mind to collectively. And you're right. CERN, Switzerland, they created the World Wide Web as we know it today. Did you know that?
Yes. Yes.
Yep. So,
you know, it's amazing, you know, and it's also amazing that, you know, you talk to the church about this stuff, and it look at you like you got three eyes or horns going out of your head, and they are just absolutely clueless.
Mm-hmm.
They're clueless, and not all of them, but the majority of them. I mean, it's like, what happened to watch as well as pray?
What happened to what? Say that again.
Watch as well as pray.
Right. Watch and pray.
Yeah, Jesus said that we won't know the day, but we'll know the hour, we'll know the season, but you got to be looking around to tell when it's going to rain.
Yeah.
You know, and the last thing I want to say is about the Vatican, that Lucifer telescope up there in Arizona.
Mm-hmm.
They call it a portal, a wormhole. It's like the spot that Jacob was at when he saw that ladder,
mm-hmm.
angels ascending, descending. So I think that's what that area is. It's a portal. It's a gateway.
I tell you, you guys that are listening to Flow of Wisdom, you guys are, this is all confirmation, because what you're saying, what Dave in Florida, Dave in Michigan called up and mentioned, as well as the guys that's hit me up on Twitter, everything that you're talking about, I have it in my notes, because trust me,
wow.
Genesis 28, it's in my notes to read, to talk about the ladder that Jacob's seen, talking about portals. Also, I'm going to get into the book of Enoch as well, the book of Enoch talking about different portals and stuff like that. So, Christina, yeah, you're on point, and that's you built a perfect segue for me, so I appreciate it.
God bless you. Thank you.
Thank you. You too. Thanks for listening. Christina in Florida. Wow. How amazing is that? She brings up Jacob in the ladder, and I have it right here in my notes. You see that? You hear that? I got it in my notes right here to reference Genesis 28, verses 10 through 17. I won't get into it right now. I'll get into that in the second hour. But what a great segue, man. Just awesome. Stephen Hawking, a recent lecture held at Harvard University, claimed that black holes could be portals to a parallel universe. There we go. I promise I will lead off the second hour sharing this article in its entirety. And I just think it's fascinating, because it all ties into things that that's going on and other things that has been done to bring us to this point. Black holes, portals, we're talking about it all. CERN, the Genesis, the Book of Enoch, Revelation. We're going to get into it all. Stick around, hour two, 6 minutes past the top of the hour. I'm Sean Anthony. This is Floor of Wisdom Radio. Motivated.